Welcome to part 1 of this new tutorial series where we'll be using Photon Fusion 2 to build a multiplayer game in Unity. If you haven't heard of Fusion before, it's basically a high-performance networking library which makes building multiplayer games in Unity simpler and more approachable. By the end of these tutorials, you'll have built a first-person parkour racing game where your goal as a player is to be the first one to reach the top of the course. To help you achieve this, you have a grappling hook, the ability to shove or temporarily immobilize other players, and several other abilities. In this first video, we're just going to set up the connection and implement basic input sampling and player movement. While we're going to build all the mechanics and write all the game-related code in these videos, we will be starting from a starter project, which you can download from the Photon website. You can also find downloads here for the state that the project is in at the end of each video. The link to this page will be in the description, but note that you'll need a Photon account to access the download. Once you've downloaded the starter project, open it up, ideally with Unity 2022.3.19. Inside, you should find Fusion pre-installed, along with the simple and advanced KCC add-ons and the Fusion menu. The various materials, basic prefabs, sounds, and other assets which we'll be using throughout the series are also included. In the main scene, you'll mainly see a bunch of UI elements, including the Fusion menu. The game scene is pretty much empty, aside from a light, a post-processing volume, and a big plane for the ground. Now first things first, you're going to need a Photon Fusion app ID. To create one, go to your Photon dashboard and then click Create a New App at the top, make sure a multiplayer game is selected, choose Fusion as the SDK, and make sure the SDK version is set to Fusion 2. Give your app a name and click Create. I already have an existing app ID, so I'm going to cancel this one. Once your app is created, copy the app ID and go back to Unity. Open the Fusion Hub from the Tools, Fusion, Fusion Hub menu and paste your app ID into the text box. You should see a green checkmark appear next to it. With that taken care of, we can now set up the connection. To do this, create a runner prefab and attach the network runner script to it. Then find the menu game object in the scene and assign the runner prefab to the menu connection behavior scripts field. At this point, we could already run the game and create a room through the menu, which would then instantiate a runner from the prefab we just gave it, but there wouldn't be anything to see or do in it, so let's spawn some players. Create a player script and a game logic script. For now, we're just going to remove the player class's default Unity methods and make it inherit from network behavior instead of from mono behavior. Our game logic class also needs to inherit from network behavior. Network behavior is something you'll use frequently when developing with Fusion, as it handles network properties and RPCs and provides a bunch of useful callbacks and other functionality which we'll be using throughout this tutorial series. Next, add a network prefab reference for our player prefab. We'll also need a network dictionary to keep track of players that connect, and we'll give it the networked attribute to make it a network property. This basically tells Fusion to replicate the property's value from the server or host client to other clients. The capacity attribute sets the absolute limit on the dictionary's capacity, and this can't be changed at runtime. I've set it to 12 because that's what I've set as the maximum number of players in the Fusion menu config. Next, we need to spawn players when they join and despawn them when they leave, which we'll do by implementing the iPlayerJoined and iPlayerLeft callbacks. To ensure that only the host initiates the spawning of players, we're going to check if we have state authority before using the network runner's spawn method to instantiate our player prefab. This will spawn the player on our host and then also replicate the spawn to the other clients so that everyone sees the player object. Then we just need to add a reference to the newly spawned player's player script to our dictionary. When a player leaves, we're going to check for state authority first, and then if the player exists in the dictionary, we'll remove him from it and despawn him. Back in Unity, open up the player prefab and attach the player script. Network behaviors can only work properly when they are attached to an object or the child of an object which has a network object component on it. Fusion conveniently detects when a network behavior is not part of a network object, and clicking this Add Network Object button will add one for us. Next, open up the game scene, find the finish object in the scene hierarchy, and attach our game logic script to it. Since this is also a network behavior, it too needs a network object component, so add that. Then assign the player prefab to the game logic script's field. If we run this now and connect, you should see that a player is spawned. However, we can't move it all, so let's implement that. We're going to need two new scripts called NetInput and InputManager. Open up the NetInput file, delete everything inside, and create an enum for the different button inputs we're going to have. For now, this will only be the jump button. Then create a struct which implements the iNetwork input interface, which will allow us to feed this struct to Fusion so it can be replicated properly to the server. To store our button presses, we'll use the handy network buttons struct that Fusion provides, and we'll need a vector2 for our movement direction. We're going to attach the input manager to our network runner prefab, and since that isn't a network object, we can't make this script a network behavior. We're going to need some of the Fusion callbacks though, and in order to make those work outside of a network behavior, we can inherit from simulation behavior instead. We're also going to implement the iBeforeUpdate and iNetworkRunner callbacks interfaces. An important concept to understand here is the difference between a frame and a simulation step or update, also known as a tick. The frame rate represents how frequently what you see on your screen is updated, and each frame can correspond to a substantially different amount of time passing. Unity lets you run code every frame by using the update method. The tick rate represents how frequently the simulation is updated, with each tick representing a fixed amount of time passing. This makes it useful for anything that needs to happen consistently, such as player movement and physics. Unity lets you run code every tick by using the fixed update method, and Fusion has an equivalent for that called fixed update network. Since our game's frame rate will likely never exactly match the simulation tick rate, we're going to accumulate input every frame and then pass that to Fusion every tick so it can be used to calculate movement. To do this, we'll need a variable to store the player's input as it's accumulated between ticks, as well as a bool to determine when the accumulated input should be reset. Before update is basically the same as Unity's update method, except that it runs before Fusion executes its network loop. We'll use this to sample input for the current frame. First things first, we're going to reset the accumulated input if necessary. Then we're going to check if either the escape or enter keys were pressed, and if so, we'll toggle the cursor lock mode and visibility. After that, we'll return out of the method if the cursor is not currently locked, because we don't want to sample input in that case. If the cursor is locked, we'll create a temporary variable to store the buttons pressed during this frame. Then we'll calculate the movement input based on which of the W, A, S, and D keys are pressed, and we'll add this vector2 to the accumulated input's direction. Next, we'll set the jump button based on whether or not the spacebar is pressed. Finally, we need to add the button presses from this frame to our accumulated input. We can do this by using the bitwise OR operator to combine the two network buttons as bits. Down in the onInput callback, we're going to normalize the accumulated direction vector before using input.set to feed our accumulated input to Fusion. Fusion will take this input and make it available to the local player as well as to the host, which allows the client to predict the local player's movement while also having the host calculate the movement authoritatively. Other clients will never see this input. At the end, we need to set our reset input bool to true, which will ensure that the accumulated input is reset when a frame is rendered in between this tick and the next. However, if the next tick is executed without a frame being rendered first, we won't have reset the input and that tick will use the same input as this tick. If we were to reset the accumulated input right here after every tick, at lower frame rates that could result in the simulation behaving as if we were constantly pressing and letting go of buttons even if we're holding them down the entire time. In the player joined callback, we'll check if the player that joined is the local player, in which case we'll lock and hide the cursor so that when you connect you can immediately start moving around. Lastly, in the onShutdown callback, which is invoked when the connection fails or we are disconnected, we'll unlock and show the cursor again. Additionally, if the shutdown was caused by plugin logic, we need to tell the menu system that we've disconnected and want to put the main menu back on screen. Over in the player class, we now need to process the input and convert it to actual movement. For now, we'll be using Fusion's simple KCC add-on to do the heavy lifting in the movement department, so add a reference for a simple KCC component. KCC stands for Kinematic Character Controller, which can be used to implement player movement that is not based on velocity or physics. This gives you as the developer greater control over how exactly the movement works and feels. The simple KCC is basically Fusion's multiplayer equivalent of Unity's regular character controller component. We'll also need values for the movement speed and jump impulse strength. Next, we're going to override the spawned callback, which is invoked once the network object has been properly initialized. Inside, we'll just set the KCC's gravity. Then we'll override fixed update network, which, as I mentioned earlier, is basically Fusion's version of Unity's fixed update method, and it's typically where you want to execute any logic that affects gameplay, such as player movement and interactions. Here, we'll call the getInput method, which retrieves the correct player's input that corresponds to the current tick that is being simulated. This will run for the local player on each client, where it will be used to predict movement, and it will run for all players on the host to preserve server authority. To calculate the world direction of our input, we can take the KCC's transform rotation and multiply it by the input direction. In order to be able to check if the jump button was pressed down this tick, we need to know whether or not it was already down during the last tick. We can keep track of this using a network buttons property. Giving it the networked attribute will ensure that Fusion stores a buffer of its values and properly sets it even during client-side resimulations. Now we can check if the jump button was pressed down by passing the previous buttons to the wasPressed method. We obviously only want to jump when the player is standing on something they can jump off of, so we'll also check if the KCC is grounded. Finally, call the KCC's move method. It's important that we normalize the world direction here before multiplying it by the speed in order to prevent cheating. A cheater could send an abnormally large vector as the input direction, and if we don't normalize it, it would allow them to move as fast as they want. We also need to make sure to update the previous buttons and set them to the current buttons. Back in Unity, open the player prefab, attach a rigid body to it, and set the angular drag to 0, use gravity to false, and is kinematic to true. Since we're setting it to be kinematic, the rigid body won't affect the player's movement at all and is only used to detect collisions. Then attach a simple KCC component, assign the player's script's reference, set its collider to the player layer, and enable both the default and player layers in its collision layer mask. You may have noticed that our player prefab doesn't have any sort of collider. This is because the KCC will actually instantiate a collider as a child of the player for us at runtime, which is what the collider layer setting is used for. Now open up the runner prefab and attach the input manager script. If you run this now and connect, you should be able to move around as long as your cursor is locked. If it isn't, press escape or enter while the game view is focused to toggle the cursor lock. Next, let's set up camera movement so that we can properly control our player. We'll need a new script for this called camera follow. Before we do anything with that though, open up the netInput file and add another vector2 to the struct for our mouse movement delta. In the input manager's before update method, we need to sample the mouse input. To do this, we can just read the mouse's delta value from the input system, switch its components so horizontal movement corresponds to a change in rotation around the y-axis and vertical movement around the x-axis, and then we can add it to the accumulated input's look delta. In the onInput method below, make sure to immediately reset the accumulated input's look delta. While we don't immediately reset movement input and button presses, doing the same with mouse input would result in a frame's mouse delta being applied multiple times if more than one tick is executed during the same frame. This would effectively cause the mouse sensitivity to fluctuate, which is not something we want. Now in the camera follow class, we're going to set up a singleton, which basically just ensures that only one instance of the class can exist at a time, and it allows us to access that instance from anywhere in our code. Add a reference to the target transform which we want the camera to follow. Make sure to assign the singleton from the awake method and set it back to null from onDestroy. In the late update method, we'll check if the target is null, and if it isn't, we'll set the camera's position and rotation to that of the target. Finally, we need a way to actually assign the target reference, so add a method that does that. Over in the player class, add a reference for the camera target transform and a value for the camera sensitivity. In the spawned method, we'll call the camera follow singleton's setTarget method if the player that was spawned has input authority. Only the locally controlled player has input authority, so this should only execute for a single player on each client. Then in fixed update network, we're going to use the KCC's addLookRotation method to add the look delta to the player rotation. This will take care of the rotation around the y-axis, but the camera also needs to rotate around the x-axis, so we need to set the cam target's local rotation based on the x component of the KCC's new look rotation. However, if you think about what we've done here, you might notice a problem. We're using late update to update the camera transform every frame, but we're only updating the target transform every tick. This means that at high frame rates, the camera movement won't look smooth. To resolve this, we can also update the cam target every frame by overriding the render method. The KCC's getLookRotation method will return a rotation that's smoothed out between ticks, so the camera movement should feel smooth, and setting the cam target's rotation in fixed update network as well ensures the simulation uses the correct rotation at all times. Back in Unity, attach the camera follow script to the main camera. Then open up the player prefab and create an empty transform as a child of the visual game object. This will be our camera's target, so assign it to the player script's cam target field. If you run this now and connect, you'll notice that you can look around as expected, but some parts of the player model are just a tiny bit in the way. To get around this, we'll just make the different parts of the local player's model only cast shadows. In the player class, start by creating an array of mesh renderers. Then in the spawned method, if this player has input authority, we'll loop through the array and set each mesh renderer's shadow casting mode to shadows only. Now in the player prefab, we just have to assign all the mesh renderers to our new array. I decided not to include the body mesh as that one doesn't interfere with the camera's view, and keeping it visible makes it possible to still see the local player in the scene view. If you run the game once more, you should now have an unobstructed view, and if you connect a second client, they should be able to see each other move around. And that's it for this video. In part 2, we'll be implementing a proper game loop that includes determining the winner, starting and restarting when all players are ready, and more. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one.